welcome to the first edition of the Sharp Dojo Series. This is a little podcast in conjunction with the SWN Podcast, set up through Luke King Sharp's online dojo, where he nominates one person about once a month to speak to me. So I don't know if it's a prize or a punishment. But I am joined this time, in this first edition, with the Hungarian soldier, Hunyadi Tamás. Welcome to the show.
Hello, thank you for the invitation. I'm really happy to be here. I don't know if it's a punishment or not at the moment, but...
We'll find out. Give it about an hour and we'll find out if it's a punishment.
We decided for the end.
Did I say your name right? I went based off the Kurt Johansson interview. That was kind of how it was said.
Yeah, you say it very well.
Excellent. That's fine.
Much clearly understood.
Perfect. I've got an easy first name, being Billy, but last name Strachan. And it sounds more complicated than it's spelled. But so I was looking at it going, I'm sure, I was hearing you had such iterations as Hyundai as well. Yeah. So, interesting ones. Right, so usually I go for the first boring question, which we'll start off with, is how did you get into pro wrestling? So what got you hooked on wrestling?
So basically, I got hooked in watching it in television. I was a bad kid, so I was turning my television all night, staying up late. And it was in a television in Hungary. And I have seen actually the John Cena CM Punk 2011 Money in the Bank match as first, which was a really, the good start to all of that. And it got me hooked straight away. Watched it most of the times after. And then I started to search, where can I do this? How can I do this? Like, okay, it's only in US, god damn it. So I have to wait until I'm 18 or something to travel and all that. And in 2000, I think first time 2013, I realized that we have something in Hungary. But by that time, I didn't really know about it. Like, okay, so what is this and how to get them? So I was waiting all the way until 2015 to reach out. Like, okay, where is the training? How can I go there? All that. Then they told me all these small informations. Then I broke my wrist, which was a fun story by that time. Well, basically, I really loved to climb trees, and it was not a good idea to do that when you are half drunk, I had to find out. So, yeah, things happen.
Oh, it's rare I get to tell about my drunken story, because I like to climb things when I'm drunk as well. And I was never going to be a wrestler. I didn't have the athleticism and I didn't have the energy or the want to actually do it. But when I'm drunk, I like to throw some elbow drops, and that's the way it happens. So when I was about 22 or something, can't remember now, I decided that I was going to do that off a bloody spinning roundabout discs, and broke my elbow in three places to the point where it doesn't actually straighten anymore. So we've got that in common, at least.
Well, I thankfully didn't broke it that much. But the fun part was I was with friends out. One of them were studying to be a doctor. And she was like, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. Then I was sleeping with my girlfriend from that time. And I couldn't sleep at all because... this thing just got whoop! And by 5 or 6 in the morning, I was just calling my mom, so this happened last night, and it may be broken, I'm not sure, but it hurts as hell, and I cannot sleep. So we went to the hospital, and the doctor, when came back, he was like, "You lucky bastard. That's 5 millimeters from a surgery, so you can just only, get the gips and go." I was like...
Oh, man. That's...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's me.
For mine, I lay there and my arm was twisted. And I just looked at it because I was drunk. I just looked at it and went, I don't think that's right. And I couldn't get, and they were like, okay, we'll go. I'm like, no, I'm not doing that either. Someone has to fund the ambulance now because I'm not moving at this stage. And yeah, it's weird how a drunken brain can just make you so calm about things. As I was sitting there with my arm obliterated, just going, I don't think this is right. I think we should phone someone, an adult, early 20s. I think we should phone an adult in this situation. So who are your early favourites then? So 2011, that's it was one of a good peak time, CM Punk, Summer of Punk at the WWE as well. So who are your early favourites? Who caught you?
I really like, already like for these day, the Miz. I just really got hooked with him from the first moment with his character, that awesome. And also back then he was doing the, because I'm the Miz and I'm awesome, you know, and it just got me hooked with that. And I can, after time, I could see also behind that he, how much work he's putting into wrestling and his life and where he came from. So it's just all the way respect to him, and like he's my favorite.
It's been amazing for you seeing him cash in at Elimination Chamber then.
Yes, I was really happy. I actually got spoiled because I was like, I cannot stay up because I have to work. And you know, the big mistake morning, Facebook, first picture I see, the Miz with the belt. And I was like, ah!
I was definitely on the fence. Because, see, well, cashing on Drew, of course. And as a Scot, I'm just like, you bastard, Miz. But at the same time, everyone's kind of got the same kind of post cash and clarity of going, he's deserved it.
Yeah,
but how
in a way, he really deserved it. Not at this moment, but for example, when he was in the feud with Daniel Bryan, I think that was 2 or 3 years ago. Now that time, I think would have been the best to put the title on him. Of course, I'm still really happy because it's, for me, it's like it's my favorite, and so I don't care who's dying or anything. He's the champ. That's cool. That's all I need.
Absolutely. So Miz being quite a big, I mean, he was a really good, he's a good wrestler. He's a safe wrestler, but he's more reliant on a character. So when you started training, was that in mind that you wanted to do a bit more of a character thing, or what was your kind of influences on your style of wrestling?
Well, at the first moment, I just basically wanted to do it. In Hungary, we have a really not specifically slow, but safe building up in the trainings. So I have been in the HCW training for 1 year, and I have never done a suplex in that 1 year. And suplex is like, you know, this extremely basic thing. Just positioning, rolls, chain wrestling, all the really basic stuff. And then because of my personal life at that time, I moved to Denmark. Then because of, again, personal problems, I couldn't afford to go for trainings. It was far away. It was not even close to me. So when I had enough money, I was going one training here, a few months out, one training here, a few months out, one training now. And the guys were really thinking that he's never going to come back ever again. Whatever, one more. And then when I got into a fixed position with money-wise, car, all that, then just every single weekend go down training no matter if I was working that day, no matter if I was waking up at 3 o'clock at the night, work, training, get home by 8, 9, tomorrow repeat, you know. So I, and yeah, then I think 4 months after I could start these weekly trainings with Body Slam, I got my debut match. And then since then, everything is just, you know, living the dream kind of, and working harder and harder to reach higher.
Absolutely. So what were you doing during that like middle periods where you, when you couldn't go to training, were you still kind of trying to keep your stamina up? Did you do sports in between that kept your cardio and your strength all up?
Basically, not really. But my work is also physical work. I work on a farm with pigs, and it can be very physical sometimes.
I would think that. Yeah, yeah.
It is actually, and yeah. Until last year, January, I was not really favorizing the gyms as well. I was like, I can do the trainings at home with myself, you know, I don't like to go to these public places and just work out. I don't even know how to do it. And then I started to talk with one of the Hungarian veteran, I can say, I think. And he started to teach me about how to put the gym program together. He was making programs for me for basically all time, and after Corona hit, so yeah, there was a bit of stop. When the gyms reopened in Denmark, then you know, full speed, and in January they shut everything again. So
we're kind of the same, except they just don't want to open anything. Yeah. So, which I mean. For someone who, like myself, who's got a body of a potato, I'm not fussed about the gyms not being open. But I know for a lot of people, it's not only a health thing, but a mental health thing, and it's a routine. And I don't understand. As long as people wipe down their sets and that, then I can't see why gyms and that haven't been opened. Because it seems to be, as long as someone's monitoring it, it would be the most... one of the cleanest places. Everyone should have their space, and that's a whole different conversation, I'm sure.
And it is actually you just mentioned, it's a mental health, and anyone who's not going to gym yet, you know, just try it and just go for, I don't know, like let's say 1-2 months, try it, because it does the difference. It makes a lot of.
Absolutely. So, so we were introduced, like I said, at the start of the show here, through the Luke King Sharp Online Dojo. So by this point, I've got you written down here, 2019 debut through Body Slam, and you had a few matches with Rick Dominic, who was a veteran over there. So how did you get introduced to Lou?
To who?
To Lou. Sorry, Luke King Sharp.
Well, my first goal after the debut was to reach all the 3 Danish promotions, and Lou is happening to work with CCW, the Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. And in 2020, February, I had my first match with them, and Louis King was actually the producer of my match, which was a pre-show match against a trainee of CCW. And as far as I remember, he was not happy with the match. So, yeah, but I know him from there.
Right, yeah, I know that Lou is, he likes to, well, I don't know about the producing match, but I know he is heavily involved in the Scandinavian scene. So from that point, I mean, not the best start then, for producing the match, and he's not happy with it. So was did it grow from there, or was it just a case you went, right, I'm starting up a dojo, I need you on it, I want to teach you something, kind of thing?
No, I am inside the CCW group, and I have seen him posting about it, and it came in a perfect time, because during that week I was asking around HCW guys, like, hey, I'm thinking about, like, I'm really stuck with the trainings and all these stuff, all this wrestling stuff. I need something. I need, you know, just anything. Just give me some knowledge or anything. Talk about wrestling, psychology, CV. I just need something. And I was also talking with the Body Slam, you know, like HCW was putting me like, hey, what about, maybe you can talk with the WXW Academy, because I'm sure that they would be hooked. And when I have seen Chris Lowking posting in CC, that I was like, I'm just, you know, reflex opening these stuffs. And I just read like, oh, Lowking Online Dojo. What? Oh, okay. I need this.
Yeah, I mean, I've said it in many places that Lou is 23, and he seems to have a mind of a veteran that's been around forever. That seems to have all these kind of little pieces that can just complete puzzles, or at least give you a guidance on where to go from there. So from what I know, I've only watched one of the webinars. I was quite lucky to be involved with, well, to watch the tag team on McGregor. So what was the kind of thing he was showing you in the first one? It was CVs, was that right?
Yeah, it was about the wrestling CVs. It's actually something that I think no one thought before as clear as he told us about, especially with the paying, like how to get paid, how to search for work, how to talk with promoters, all this stuff. I think when I was at the WXW Academy, there was one day we talked a bit about it, you know, to talk with respect, don't be afraid to write to them. But I don't remember if they were mentioning like, okay, this is how you make your CV, what you put into it, how Louis King is making it, and about any paying, how to travel, who's paying the travel, flying, no flying. I never heard anyone talk about that. So it was really helping a lot. And also I think part of me got into the Nations Club because of this, with the IWA.
That's definitely on one of my notes I've got here. But the bit about getting paid and how to work it out is, it seems to be almost a taboo subject.
But I think it's always everywhere. Like at the work, we also have this don't talk about your salary to each other, you know. And I think it's the same with wrestling. Like money is not something you really want to talk about, because what then, that guy is getting more than you, or his flight is booked, you have to buy your own. His guest money is handled, yours is not. You know, all these little stuff that can make you just get pissed, or, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
I think that's why.
Yeah, and it's definitely, especially in this updated day and age with transparency, I think it's important to do that, because there's no sense in, I mean, what if you're wrestling, you haven't negotiated a wage, you've broke your wrist again, and that means you've had to miss time out work, you've not been compensated, you haven't been paid for the initial match, and it's just a whole can of worms that hopefully nowadays we should be avoiding. But you know, there'll always still be places that'll try and chance their arm for a spot or two. So yeah, speaking about the IWA Nations Cup, so it's out in Italy. You're representing Hungary.
Yes, I do.
So you said, you mentioned that because of the CVs and that, you're able to, you that was in part how you got in, but what made you want to get involved with IWA Nations Cup?
I have seen them posting about it, and I couldn't see a better person to represent Hungary as the soldier, you know, like a Hungarian soldier, basically. I, you know, the bad part is that is in it that I live in Denmark, not in Hungary, but it's still like the character, and that I represent Hungary in Denmark as well, not Denmark. So I'm with a Hungarian name, not with an English name or Danish name. So I think it still matters a lot, like where your heart is coming from, not that where I live or anything. And it looks really exciting. Like, that means I can talk or have a conversation, have a match with 15 other cultures. That's just so great, you know. And also, maybe one of the countries have a different kind of wrestling, different kind of mindset. So it's giving me so much possibility to learn from one another, and also to give my not so many experience compared to the others that I see in the Nations Cup so far, but it's something, you know.
It's an exciting way to be thrown into the deep end again. I mean, 2020 was a write-off for many reasons, although I think for yourself, you still kept yourself pretty busy with wrestling, because it's shows were still getting put on, and you're able to complete your trifecta in Denmark as well. But yeah, it's always any chance you can get, I suppose, to exactly. Learn something new.
Exactly, and also Louis King was telling the same during the CV every time, like, if you have a chance, go for it, because if you wait just a minute, two other guys maybe will be before you. And if you wait a day, 100 guys will be ahead of you already.
Absolutely, yeah. And who knows? I mean, it could have been a line of guys at HCW just waiting to hit send, and yours just came through first, and it might never have happened. So initially we were going to kind of speak, well, I was hoping to speak yesterday. Just that was my timeline in my head, but you were actually in a seminar with Sin Bodhi, who of course was Kazarni for a brief minute in WWE, and I think he was in TNA quite a bit as well. So again, is this just a case of just trying to absorb as much information as you can while we're all kind of stuck at home?
Of course, and also like when we are having the in-ring training that has almost nothing to do with things that you have to talk about, not be in the ring and do it actually. And what somebody was telling yesterday, it was about timing and ring positioning. I don't think that at least half of the things we could have not done inside the ring during a training session.
A lot of times nowadays, wrestling, the wrestling's almost the secondary bit. It's about the emotion of the crowd and getting to pull them in. I mean, I watched your match with Michael Flynn, and I could see that you were kind of trying to draw in the crowd, and even as a, I was hearing you speaking to Kurt as well, that you've been kind of experimenting with using your Hungarian-ness, I'll say the word, but being Hungarian to draw up the ire of a Danish market as well. So yeah, I mean, you could wrestle a great match, but if you've got the crowd either behind you or vehemently against you, that's the key thing to get you back for future shows, I suppose.
Yeah, and that's what I really try to get, and mainly to get comfortable with it, because I was always a very shy guy. I still am, but I'm working on it really hard. And actually, one of my friends told me, like, who have seen me wrestle also, that I'm a totally different person in my personal life and when I go out to the ring, because she doesn't see that shy person anymore, because you just go out front of 100, 200 people, then get half naked and basically work.
So. That's the thing, yeah. I mean, when I was doing my research, I'm going to mention it so many times because it was a great interview, but I was watching the Kurt Johansson interview with yourself on one screen, and then I had your match with Michael Flynn on the other, and I'm like going, how is this the same guy? Because yourself, you're quite shy and not withdrawn, but just like you hold back a little bit, you're careful of thinking, and I'm watching a match with Michael Flynn, and you're just like, running through him, or you're picking up Rick Dominic, and you're shouting at him. You're doing all this emotive stuff, and then I come back to your interview with Kurt, and you're just like, "Yeah, it's fine. I like wrestling." And it's such a great. I see it so many times. Especially when I'm doing these interviews now, that I'm speaking to wrestlers, and I don't think they realize they change so much in that moment between the entrance music hitting and going out and putting on a show. One of the comments made me laugh was you got a lot of John Cena chants.
Yeah.
Started.
Especially during the last CCW show, it was an intergender match. And yeah, it's like, you fuckers. But I was a heel, so I could work with that, which gave me the option to be an asshole. So, and I actually felt really comfortable, you know, just shouting back to the Danish guys in Hungarian, and I was just basically shouting that I don't understand what you talk about. Shut up. You shut up. Like, then I think one of them was calling me Captain America, and it was quite funny because yesterday during the webinar, somebody was calling me Captain Hungary. Like, not again.
Who knows? Maybe that's the future. You can come out with the Captain Hungary.
Yeah, just evil of the Hungarian soldier, Captain Hungary. And then my the big gimmick is gonna be like, this is Hungary, yes.
get your own shield and just use it to smack guys about. There's money in that somewhere, somehow.
It's like $1 million.
Exactly. So, like I say, you kind of play your trade mainly in Denmark. You live in Denmark. Outside of being obviously a Hungarian soldier. So, what would be your pick of some of your favorite matches that you've had so far?
My favorite so far was against Finn, because he's really good, and he was basically talking to me during the whole match, but not like making me laugh or anything, just, you know, like, relax, you know, calm down, be slower, don't rush, just easy. You know, and reminded me on spots, but the thing is that if I know I'm really stressed about, if I remember the spots and all, so I actually remember everything, kinda, hopefully. So I was like, why does he tell me the spots? I know the spots, like, yeah, just, you know, I'm fine, you know, it's easy. We are just in the co-main event, no worries, just chill. So, but it was relaxing to hear him talking and everything. And for me, I could really take out a lot out of it, because as soon as I got the recordings, I was like, okay, I want to listen the whole recording in silent. I want to hear him talking, because he was talking all match long. And I couldn't hear him talking. So for me, that was like, okay. So I can talk really easily to anything, anyone, because I will not even hear in the recordings next to the ring. So for me, there was a takeaway from that match in this way.
It's incredible skill. I mean, I mean, I've watched wrestling since I was, well, actually the first moment I remember from wrestling came up on Twitter, WWE's Twitter. So I've watched since 1999, and I still have no idea how they do the whole talking thing. And I mean, you see it sometimes if it's like a John Cena who likes to shout, but like, I still don't get it. And it's the bit, it's the magic that always keeps me coming back going, how I don't have, my memory is like a sieve. When we stop chatting and I hit stop recording, I'm literally going to forget everything we spoke about and I'm going to have to listen back to it again. So I don't
know
how anyone,
the same for me.
Yeah, I don't know how anyone can put together a match and be safe. It's just, you know, it's an incredible skill, and I just, yeah, it makes me just go, like, wrestlers are still superheroes to me because they can do that.
I think in a way it's also in the reflex, because I also like to, as I call it, dance the match by myself, you know, once or twice with my partner if there is time for it. And because of that, it gets into my reflex for that night. So as soon as, you know, he touched me somewhere, let's say beat me in the corner, aha, that's what's coming. Yeah. So
that's amazing. I
think it's just getting the reflex by that. And of course, when you have 20 years of experience, that's just when it's really a magic.
Yeah, it just becomes like a second nature kind of thing as well. So yeah. Go back to right to the start briefly. So what was it like taking that first bump then? Of course, you've had experience, of course, with the old wrist break, but you're under the influence at that point. So what was it like taking that kind of damage sober?
Ooh, my first bump was the worst. It hurted so much because I landed bad. So all my lungs came out and like, oh, is it all gonna be like this? All my respect, people. Well, let's take next. So it was something like that.
So, I mean, the one thing that, I mean, it sounded like you didn't have, like everything you said was like slowly, you had to learn the basics before you got to do
And that was the same with the bumps. First, in Hungary, when we were learning the bumps, we literally had to lay down and just do the hit the mat. Nothing else. Just hit the mat. Then you were going, you know, like more of a bit more up, sit up, do the same. Then, you know, basically squatting, go back, hit, do the same. Now you can try take one bump if you want.
So yeah, I mean, I suppose in one way it's like you know how to fall. As long as you know how to fall, that is pretty much you're going to be fairly safe in the ring, at least for yourself. You know that you're going to land okay. But the other hand, you're probably, as a fan, you're probably sitting there going, "Come on, I want to do some flips. I want to do a tope con hilo, and I want to do all the fancy moves," but
that was the hard part in back in Hungary, because when I was going there, of course, as everyone, I was expecting that AA at the first day, no problem, RKO, oh, of course, and then, you know, for 1 year, nothing, not a move. And but also because of that, I got the mindset of don't rush the things, and the fact that it is worth to wait for it. If you do it at the first day, you fuck yourself up. If you don't believe it because it looks cool and everything, you just ruin yourself. It's not worth it.
That and well as well, you're probably sitting there, if you spent your first 3 weeks doing RKOs, and then the fourth week they're going, right, we're going to do some drills where you're going to do this really small movement, you'll be like, I don't need to do that, I can do an
RKO.
This
is boring.
Yeah, I'll go do some 450s instead. Way more fun. But then that means you're probably going to hurt someone. very soon.
Yeah, probably very soon. But I actually, because of the roles, I planning, and because we don't have in-ring trainings and I have a quite big room, let's say, I'm just planning like, okay, I'm going to buy 5 mats, put it down in my room and I'm going to roll, baby. I'm just going to roll back and forth. That's going to be my warm-up or something.
Excellent. So you've really become a, you went from, I'm just doing bumps every week, not that much else. Now you've become properly a student of the game, like saying you're trying to just grab all these pieces of information that you can get.
Exactly.
I was seeing that you also had a seminar with Speedball Mike Bailey, which when you think about your wrestling style that I've seen, it's very different to what Speedball does. Because of course he's more of a high flyer and you're more of a grounded.
Yeah, but brawler. But at the same time, maybe at one point I will have to fight against a 2-meter guy who's twice of me, also like in wide, and then I cannot really do my style. So I have to go. I want to be able to do most of the styles as much as I can, because at the same time, if I know every single style, then I can, you know, just put them all together and create something that is mine. And that's taking, and what will make me better.
A hybrid. Basically.
Yeah, and also hybrid.
If you could be a chameleon. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I hadn't thought about it until just you said that. But if you learn from Speedball, of course, you'll be the guy that's, you have to be the base for his kind of wrestling. So you learn a bit more about timing and all that kind of stuff. So like I say, between the dojo and the Simbodi and Mike Bailey and everyone else, it's just finding that extra piece of a puzzle to make the bigger picture. Now, on the dojo, coming up, their guests, we've got the likes of Selena De La Renta, Big Buffa, Bull James, and it was just incredible that was just announced recently.
I'm looking so forward to all of it, because talking with the producer, talking with someone going Asia and around the world since 10 or 20 years, I'm not sure about for how many years he's active, and then ex-WWE and TNA stars, ECW stars, like, wow. You know?
I mean, I know this series is due to being the Sharp Dojo series, so it can possibly end up being a huge advert for it. But it's quite incredible that he's brought that Lou has brought in so many different, like I'm saying, different pieces of that puzzle, because we had Krieger, tag team guy, had Buffa, like I said, Asian market, he's wrestled all over the East. You got the producer, Selena, you got the guys who've made it to the actual WWE, Bull James and just incredible. So it really is, right now, nobody's training physically. It's one of the best ways to get involved. And as someone, I'm lucky enough, I'll be speaking to Krieger tomorrow. So hopefully I'll be able to delve into that tag team psychology a little bit more. I mean, I'm not even wrestling. I wrote a page of notes. I don't know how that happened.
Me too, I mean, I'm a wrestler.
I expect you to write notes.
But I'm not a tag wrestler. But who knows? And it's still, as we see WWE, you can be in a tag team in 5 seconds. So, and also it's just good to know. But what are the rules? What are you doing? What you should do? What you have to do? All these little things just come together, and then at one point someone will tell me, I got a tag match for you today, is that okay? Of course it's okay, let's go.
I know all the rules.
Of course. I'm already a professional before I tried.
That's the thing. I mean, I didn't even think, I mean, I knew like briefly what the rules are. I've watched it for that long. I've kind of got the gist of it. But after speaking to Krieger in our tag team seminar, I watched America's Most Wanted against Three Live Crew. It was on TNA. I'm in a bit of a TNA mood at the moment. They had it on YouTube. And I was watching it going, oh, there's that little thing that Krieger said. Here's that little thing. There's this. And it's like, I never noticed how technical all this thing was until someone's told me that it is that technical. Right. So.
And these little things that you just say, like, also 2 or 3 days ago, I was asking, I think Louis King was sharing it on the dojo group, that someone with 20 years of experience in the US was posting on Twitter that he does he can give a match feedback. And I was like, okay, hi, sir, you know, blah, blah, blah. Here is the match. Is it okay? Not okay, like, you know. And the day after, he came back to me, wrote me a shitload of things. Then I wrote, you know, first I watched the match again, reading what he was writing and where he was writing. And like, oh, well, oh, okay. Yeah, I see, I see. Yeah, yeah, that looks like shit. Oops. And, you know, after that moment, it was like, yeah, that's fine.
I mean, that's the thing. Wrestling is so subjective, but you've got the likes of Lance Storm's doing Tyson Ducks. He's doing these seminars, these feedbacks, and Shading the Trust, who I think was one that you did from down Carlisle, so around about the borders of Scotland and England. But nowadays, I think wrestlers don't have an excuse to not learn because there's so many. There's Zoom. There's this, there's webinars, seminars, like actual physical ones, there's match feedbacks. And it's great to hear that you're just trying to absorb as much as you possibly can, which I've said before, numerous times in this chat we're having. But yeah, there's absolutely no excuse now for wrestlers to not get feedback.
In a way, I also had to get here because since the lockdown, I had a bit of, you know, the lockdown again. Yeah, nothing to do. Yeah, so just work, home, back to work, home. And I just got basically bored of it. And that's when I was starting to, you know, just chatting up everyone. Hey, do you want to make like a psychology lesson or something? You know, like, I want something. Give me something. I'm bored as hell.
That's the thing. That's why I started doing podcasts in general, because I started it in June last year because there's no shows to write about. So I couldn't write about anything. I was like, I'm much like yourself, quite a shy person. I don't particularly like speaking to people, but I was starting to even miss human interaction by the time June came around. And then apparently we went to lockdown 3. I don't remember lockdown 2 particularly, but it's just like, I'm booking in so many guests now for podcasts because I'm actually liking speaking to folk. I'm very scared when lockdown gets lifted and I'm expected to do it face to face, but it's a bridge we'll cross. Right, so before we kind of wrap up, because I want to keep these kind of to about an hour, we've got some odd questions that I like to ask in our normal podcast.
Oh, let's
go. One of which is the first time it'll be publicly because I've only added it to the last 2 or 3 episodes. First one is, as always, what's your favourite dinosaur?
T-Rex.
Told you it was weird.
I like the smaller.
The T-Rex. It's a classic. Yeah. Tyrannosaurus. And the other one, which started with the episode I've got coming up with Luke King Sharp, and will forever continue. What would win in a fight? 2 sheep or 1 cow?
1 cow.
Awfully quickly there. Have you got any reasoning, or is it just gut?
Yeah,
decision?
Because I was studying. I'm a farmer educated guy, so I know their size differences. The cow, the only bad thing with the cow that it's lazy as fuck. So, but I think if it's lying on the 2 sheep, easy win. So, I mean, it's still 500 kilo we talk about.
I mean, I forgot when you said you worked on a farm that you literally will have the expertise for this question. I'm still pulling for 2 sheep. I'm still thinking 2 sheep could do it. if they work together. I don't know how sheep's brains work, but I'm hoping we'll never find out, because I don't want to watch it. I think that would be really, really sad to watch two sheep fight a cow. But one day we might find out.
I wouldn't think the cow would fight, because it's just a so lazy animal. It's just eating grass, laying down, That's all he does. If that would be my life, I would be dead by now.
To be honest, I think that is my life sometimes, outside of speaking on Zoom. Right, so before we wrap up, what's your immediate goals then? Say your five-year plan, wrestling comes back tomorrow. Where do you want to be? Is it AEW, New Japan, NXT, WWE? What's your goal?
My big goal is basically to make a living from it, a fixed living. And after that, I didn't decide it yet, but I want to travel the world before signing with anyone, if I get there, and I think I will. But yeah, first big goal is to make a living of it, and when I'm able to quit my job and just live basically from wrestling and giving seminars, selling merchandises, then I think that's the point when I can think about what's next for me.
Absolutely. And
to reach this point, I just, you know, always have small goals. Like I said, when I made my debut, okay, I want to reach all the three Danish promotions. And when I did that, I was like, okay, that was quite fast. Now I want to make a booking abroad. Well, Hello Nations Club. Club. Hello Nations Club.
So you're hitting your goals.
Yeah. And I basically, when the IWA came back to me, I think I was just playing on my PC when I, you know, phone popped up and there was an IWA escape. Okay. And I was literally crying reading that. So, yeah, you're on. And I'm like, oh my God. And for 1 hour after that, I was just calling people like, oh my God, I made it. Oh my God, I'm so happy.
That's the thing. I mean, now you said that if you put out into the world that you're just going to make a living and travel the world and then sign with someone once you've done all that, by what you've told me already, there's a high chance that'll happen. You seem to have the go-to and the drive to do it. So hopefully myself and Kurt, whoever's interviewed in the last 12 months, we're getting the exclusive. We're getting it just before you hit it big and start tearing it up. Who would be your fantasy opponent? So you could pick anyone to face, past, present, future. What would be your dream match?
I'd say The Miz for this one also, because I just want to have that experience.
I thought that would be your answer.
just see your favorite up against yourself. I don't know how different I would be in that moment, and would I don't know, just, you know, make a small cry before we start to kill each other? Or would I cry during the entrance, like when Edge returned and then, you know, back in the game kind of thing? So I just want to see myself, how I would react for that.
I mean, it could be a WrestleMania main event in 5 years' time. Who knows at this stage? I always like asking that question, because it's like, oh, I like to face so-and-so. And with The Miz, like I say, he's got the reputation of being just absolutely safe. He's absolutely solid in the ring. He knows how to get a reaction out of the crowd. One of my favourites is Jeff Hardy, who knows how to do that, but would probably literally kill me, because he's got this style of wrestling that it would just be like, no, I'd never want to do that. I don't want the ladders. I don't want tables. Forget all that.
Oh, with all that, I'm like, I want to try everything that I can, but if I try it, I want a reason for it, a story. Mm-hmm. Why am I making it? So for example, with the chair shots, it was a hardcore match against Drake Dominic. So like, that's a basic in a hardcore match. Let's do it. Or I was breaking a table against Ragnar in Dance Pro Wrestling. And like, yeah, that was fine. Yeah, that's comfortable. As far as you can say that. Then, yeah, it like, yeah, all these things I want to try out, see how I would enjoy it. And yeah.
It's one of those things, yeah. You've only got so many, the old adage is, you've only got so many bumps on your bump card. So let's just do it. Let's just take things as they come. And you're not going to get phoned up and just go, right, next week you're in a barbed wire exploding landmine match. Like, why? Just because. Still a reason.
No, so, yeah, no, that's not me.
You've got so many things on your bump card, just don't want to use them all up in your first year. But yeah, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me tonight.
Thank you for having me.
I absolutely have thoroughly enjoyed our chat. I'm so glad that we've both understood each other as well.
Thank you, and me too. I was a bit afraid of the accent, but I got used to it, and it got, now it's really easy to understand. So,
to be honest, Lou is on the other end of the accent. It's really strong. I find it difficult sometimes. I'm from like the northeast of Scotland, which sometimes is just a run-on sentence, but it's a little bit softer to the ear. But before we go, though, people's got to know, where can people find you on social media?
It's I think everywhere is Hunyadi Tamás 97. You will never find out I was born in 97. So, and yeah, on Facebook, if someone can want to chat me up, it's just Hunyadi Tamás. I'm kind of friendly sometimes.
You're on the TikTok yet or anything like that?
I only have Instagram and Twitter and the Facebook.
Excellent, that's all you need. Perfect. Again, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you for the invitation.
Excellent.
And have a great day.
You too.